So now let's talk about Amdahl's law. So it's very related to what I was just explaining about the speed up that we can get from multithreading. So let's look at, consider this. So I have this program. And one quarter of this program is not parallelizable because of dependencies. So I'm going to call it S for sequential. So this is one quarter of this program is sequential. It cannot be parallelized because it has lots of dependencies in it. And the remaining three quarters are parallelizable. I can parallelize them because there is enough independent work that can be, that will allow me to divide this into threads. Now suppose that I divide this, I manage to divide this into threads, into two threads. So I will get this. Now this is going to be the sequential part, which takes one quarter. And if I divide this into two threads, it's going to look like this. So I have P1 and P2. I divided it into two threads. Now, assuming that I divided it equally, what will this time be? What would this be? So this is 3/4 of the program's time. If I divide it into two threads and I execute them in parallel and everything is perfect, this would be what?
3/8.
Yeah, so it's going to be 3/8. So it's going to be 3/4/2. So my speed up in this case, the speed up is going to be 1. So this is 1. Divided by this number, this that is less than 1, which is 1/4 plus 3/8. And this is going to be 1 divided by 2/8 plus 3/8. And this is 8/5 or 1.6. So my speed up here is 1.6. So this 1.6 tells me that because I have this sequential part, that I could not parallelize the whole program, I only parallelized part of it, or 3/4 of it in this case, my speed up was 1.6, not 2.0. Right? Now, yes?
You mentioned overhead, but you don't account for it?
Yeah, exactly. So here, this is the idea, without accounting for any kind of overhead. So we are ignoring here, we're ignoring the, or let's call the ideal conditions. Ideal conditions, we are ignoring system overhead, which is thread creation, and context switching, etc. We are also ignoring process synchronization and communication, or thread. Again, this concept applies equally well to multi-threading and multi-processing. In fact, because we are ignoring, the overhead, it's the same concept. But in reality, we expect the overhead when we do multi-processing to be more significant, right, than when we do multi-threading. Because creation and context switching for threads is faster than creation and context switching for processing. So we're also ignoring thread communication and synchronization. we are ignoring that these threads must communicate, or in general, they will be communicating, and there will be some kind of synchronization. And what's the other assumption?
Well, it's not something that we are ignoring. It's not ignoring, so ignore system overhead, ignore thread communication and synchronization. And what's the other idealization that we are assuming here? In doing this calculation, what's the ideal assumption, the idealization assumption that we are making in this calculation?
The threads are doing the same amount of work.
Yeah, exactly. We're assuming perfect balance. They're doing the same amount of work. So we're assuming perfect balance or perfectly balanced load. So we're getting 1.6 here with system overhead and thread communication and synchronization, and the fact that in real life, most of the time, you know, the threads are not going to be doing the same amount of work, or the load will not be perfectly balanced. The actual speed up that we get is going to be less than 1.6. Right? We expect to get, so this is the ideal or the upper bound that we can get. Okay, now what if we have speed up with 4 cores? Speed up with 4 cores. Of course, under the same ideal conditions. What would the speed up with 4 cores? It's going to be speed up equals 1 divided 1 over 4 plus 3 over 16. Right. And this is going to be 16 over 7. 16 over 7, and 16 over 7 is 2 point something. 2 and 2 sevenths. So here, the maximum speed up with 2 cores is 1.6 instead of 2. The maximum speed up with 4 cores is 2.3 instead of 4. Now what if we have an infinite number of cores with an infinite number of cores? The speed up is going to be what? 1 plus 1 over 4 plus 0. So if you have an infinite number of cores, then, you know, infinite parallelization, then in the limit, the amount of work that each thread will be doing will be 0. Of course, this is very theoretical. Right? It's, well, in reality, there is no infinite number of cores. And in reality, it's dividing your program into more threads is harder. As the number of threads gets larger, it will get harder to find independent work that can be done by multiple threads. So this is going to be 4. So even if you have an infinite number of cores, you're not going to get speed up by a factor of infinity. You'll get speed up by a factor of 4. And this is the ideal. Still, this is the ideal without taking into account system overhead, without taking synchronization, and assuming that the load is perfectly balanced.
So in a realistic world where we have to deal with these assumptions we made for the ideal conditions, would we have diminishing returns because of that? So is there a limit to how much you can divide your processes or threads by before it's not worth doing so?
Yeah, so usually it's not, these are hard to calculate. And in many cases, you just try it and see if you get speed up or not. So in reality, parallel programming tends to be experimental. So you just divide the program into threads, and you do your best to minimize
there isn't much that you can do with the system overhead, but with the synchronization, you try to minimize the synchronization. By the way, synchronization is something that we will be studying in detail in chapter 5. But you try to minimize the synchronization, and you try to come up with the independent pieces of work for the different threads, and you try to balance the load. So it's about, you know, balancing and minimizing synchronization, and you hope that this will give you speed up, and you try it. You may get speed up, you may not, depending on how much independence, how much independent work there is in the program. Okay. So usually you will not get the real answer that you get is what you get when you implement this and you try it, and you measure the speed up. Any questions on Amdahl's law? So this is the formula, the general formula, 1 divided by S, which is the sequential fraction, plus 1 minus X, 1 minus S, which is in our case, in this example, is 3/4 divided by N, the number of cores, so the number of threads, because here we are ideally assuming that each thread will be run on a separate core. So this gives us the general formula. Okay, so in this example, S is 1 over 4. So if you plug in 1 over 4, you will get this. And N is what? In the first example, it was 2. Then we did 4. Then we did infinity.